This is Ask GMBN Tech, our weekly Q&A show. You ask the questions, we give you the answers. If you want to ask a question, get involved. The email address is at the bottom of the screen there, hellotech@gmbn.com. And if you want to ask your questions in the comments, use that hashtag AskGMBNTech and get involved in the conversation below. We love hearing from you. So first up this week is from Carolis Burkertus. I've got some Hope Tech 3 V4s that uses dot fluid. I wonder, can I replace the fluid with mineral oil? Would there be any benefit? No, in a word. They're completely different oils, dot fluid and mineral fluid. They're not interchangeable in any way. Now, the reason for this is dot fluid essentially can be corrosive to seals and O-rings and all the other internal components, even including the hoses on some brakes, and mineral fluid is completely different. So DOT stands for Department of Transportation. Now, it's a regulated fluid. There's different categories in there. And it's designed to withstand certain boiling temperatures. Obviously, this is certified for motion vehicles like motorbikes, cars, lorries, that sort of thing. So they have to adhere to that in order for safety. Now, a lot of bicycle brakes use DOT fluid in them for good reason. But also, a lot of brakes, let's say Shimano, as opposed to your Hope brakes, use mineral fluid. Now, that's an unregulated fluid, but a good thing about that is it can be designed to spec for the exact brakes. So Magura brakes, for example, make and manufacture their own specific mineral fluid to be compatible with their brakes to their exact spec. And the same with Shimano. Now, you can interchange some mineral fluids, but not all. They are slightly different, and the manufacturers do stipulate that, even though we have made it work with many different brakes before. The best bet is just use the recommended oil for your brakes and you will not run into any problems. Okay, next up is a shifting related question from Leo Malloy. Ask GMBN Tech, can you please ask for Neil's opinion on the gripshift Eagle on his Canyon Lux? I'm considering buying it for myself. Before we get involved with that, grip shift, in case you don't know, compared to regular under the bar trigger style shifters, is literally a section of the grip that you can twist to change gear. Now, they were really popular in the 90s, although the ones back in the 90s were actually terrible. They had a huge throw on them in order to change gear. And you'd see riders as they're racing, literally grabbing big arms full of throw in order to shift a couple of gears, which is a terrible idea when you consider that your grip is your control area. Now, the latest version of the grip shift, they're probably the lightest shifters available because there's barely any moving parts. You do the moving as opposed to mechanical components on the inside. They're very reliable because of this. And of course, you move your hand position in order to change gear. It's entirely up to you. Now, they're super popular on the XC World Cup scene because they're so light and because of the way you use them. But I know that Neil's not that much of a fan. So Neil said, it didn't suit the way I ride with my right hand on the end of the bar. Yeah, so quite an important thing. A lot of downhill style riders and enduro riders like to have their hands almost hanging off the end of the grip. And I know that Neil has the end of the grip imprints nearly on the sort of middle of his heel of his hand here. So of course, to use the grip shift, he would need to cut his grips right down, in which case he'd be almost on the grip shift itself. So not good for him. He had to move it a lot to shift, but he did like the way you could bang through the gears really fast and it shifted really well. I've actually just made a super easy switch to an Eagle NX shifter. So he's using the regular under the bar shifter, but he does praise the fact that you can just go and do a whole load of gears. And the same if you're in a really high gear coming into a climbing situation, you can just load up a whole bunch of low gears in one go. Whereas under the bar style levers, you can obviously change the placement of the shifter itself. It doesn't always work out for you if you want to just dump a load of gears. You can only do a certain amount depending on the shifter. I think they're really cool. I haven't actually used grip shift for some time, but I'd definitely be keen to in the future. It's a lot of money to spend, so if you can, try out a bike first just to see if it suits the way you ride. But they're great. There's nothing wrong with them. They're just different. All right, next from Gareth McDoyle. Doddy, I'm just wondering what your opinion is on angle style headsets that Ken Creek, Works Components and Slackerizer make. I was thinking of making one my next mod on my 2010 Kona Kadabra. Are Zeds and EC headsets interchangeable? Thanks, Doddy. Love the show. It's helped me out many times in numerous bike repairs. Awesome, thank you. Well, first up, the Z and EC. I'm actually not sure if they are compatible, but an easy way to check this is a proper good cheat system. Just going to throw you on screen right now is the Cane Creek headset finder. It's a really cool system. It has most bike frames you could possibly imagine in there, or at least you're going to be able to find one that's got the same configuration as yours, and it'll tell you exactly what style upper and lower units are compatible in your bike, including Zs, ZSs, all that stuff. So that's super helpful. But as far as actual angled headset cups go, I think they are fantastic, and you can really, really tune the way your bike feels. Now, the different types, I'm not so too familiar with the Slackerizer, but I've got a Works component and I've got several Cane Creek angle sets laying around. Now, the angle set really is the king because of the fact it's adjustable. So it's a simple system. You have two different sets of cups, top and bottom. Then you have kind of like a gimbal, effectively, that sits inside that and enables it to move to the angle that the cup allows. And then you lock it all down as you would with a conventional headset. Now, this setup is really, really good because of the fact you can adjust it 0.5 degrees at a time, normally up to 1.5 degrees, but sometimes up to 2 degrees depending on the configuration of your particular frame. Now, this is fantastic because if you buy it and you say you want to take a degree and a half off and it's too much, you can put a half degree back on and settle on that 1 degree, which is fine. However, you do get some issues, especially with longer travel forks, and on some configurations they can creak if not installed absolutely pinpointly perfect, because that gimbal system can move. We're talking like a microscopic amount, but that's enough to lead to creaking. It can drive you crazy. Now, they are absolutely fine as long as they are installed completely perfectly, but this can be hard to get it that precise. So for that reason, I do prefer going for something like the Works components, which is a fixed cup. But in order to do that, you do need to know the angle you want to go for. Otherwise, it starts getting expensive, having to buy a 0.5, a 1, a 1.5, etc. So work out really what you want to do and weigh up on the cost. Obviously, the Works components will be slightly cheaper as well. And once it's fit and forget. It's just going to do the job exactly as you want it to. Now, if your bike, say, had a 66 degree head angle, I'd be fine taking off a degree because you can adjust a degree, but taking off a degree and a half is going to change quite a lot on your bike. It will lower the front end very slightly, it will steepen your seat angle very slightly, all minute things, but that head angle will have a dramatic effect on the handling of your bike. Now, I've had friends that have gone the whole hog, the 1.5 degrees before, and actually not liked it. They found it's gone too far for them. So sometimes half a degree or a degree is all you need. So if possible, try something out with a similar head angle to what you're trying to get to first, but it's not always going to be that simple. They do vary. So if you're a fettler, maybe the angle set is the best way to go. But if you're not quite sure and you don't want to mess around with that stuff, pick a number, half a degree or a degree, commit to it. And if you don't like it, sell it and buy the one that you do like. Okay, so this is actually a really cool question. This is from Alfonso Lizarazo. Great video, thanks. I still don't understand how rear shocks are measured. For example, I have 120mm travel fork at the front and it's actually 120mm. I can measure that on Sunrise to determine the percentage I'm using so I can adjust it. But on the rear, I have 120mm travel. But how do you measure it? The shock obviously isn't 120mm. Can you please enlighten me on that? Okay, Alfonso. So the first thing to think about it is the fork is telescopic. So what you see is what you get. You measure 120mm, that is what you're getting. At the rear shock, you've got anything up to about 65mm of movement on the shock itself, and it will translate to more travel at the wheel axle. The amount the wheel axle moves is 120mm in your case. Now, obviously, the shock moves a little bit, the wheel is further away, so that's what it equates to. It's kind of like looking at a seesaw. So if I was just to say that this Allen key was your pivot point, and then, for example, on this end of this screwdriver is your shock, and that end is your wheel, it's something like this. So your rear shock moves a tiny bit, and the wheel moves a lot. So it's called the leverage ratio. So this can obviously change depending on how much travel the shock has and the configuration of the suspension on a bike. So if your bike was to have a 2-to-1 ratio, for every 10 millimeters that the shock moves, the rear wheel will move 20 millimeters. It's that simple. Now, there's loads of different suspension designs on bikes out there, and they all have different leverage ratios, different length shocks. There's a lot of configurations. So the way to do this is you set up your shock with a percentage of the sag on that. So you don't have to worry about the 120 millimeters. If your shock has got 60 millimeters of stroke, you can work out a percentage from that. Now on some shocks, you will even have markings on the actual shock shaft itself to help you work out, like this one on the screen, whether you've got 20, 30 or 40% sag. So you can set up to your desired amount. Just use a percentage of the available travel, which on any rear shock, it will compress the whole amount of that shaft. So that is where you measure your sag. Okay, so last question is from Dwight Jackson. I really like your videos. I just bought my first mountain bike, which is a used 2013 Santa Cruz Tallboy C. I live in Jamaica, where there isn't a lot of trail riding, but it is very possible given the makeup of the country. The bike has dual shock absorbers with 100 mil of travel, which from watching your videos, I think will be fine for what I'm doing. However, I want to know if it's possible to safely change out the shock absorbers to 110 rear and 120, 130 on the front, or can I get the existing 100 mil absorbers to perform like 120 by adding those things I've totally forgot the name of? Well, firstly, Dwight, awesome to hear from someone in Jamaica. I know there's not a massive riding scene over there, but I have heard of a bike park over there. I've got a feeling it's a private park, but either way, it's country I'd absolutely love to visit at some point. I'm stoked to hear from someone over there. All right, so firstly, your bike is absolutely fine for most things you're ever gonna throw at it. So the Tallboy and 29 inch wheels is gonna eat up what you throw at it, no problem. It's got a really stout frame with 100 millimeters of travel front and rear. Now out back, you can't extend that travel, unfortunately. Even if you could fit a longer shock into that frame design, it's gonna change angles too much and gonna mess up the handling of the bike. But chances are you won't even be able to fit one in there because of the way the back end won't be able to extend enough to cater for the additional length needed on the shock. But your shock is absolutely fine on there. Now, depending on what model of shock you have, whether you have a Fox or a RockShox unit on there, there were different options available. So if you leave a comment underneath this video in response to this answer, I'll see if I can give you some more specifics. Now you should, in theory, be able to fit air volume spacers, which I think is what you're talking about, into that shock. Now you don't always need these on a bike. Now the Santa Cruz Tallboy has got a nice feeling back end on there. It can feel a little linear, but that does make it feel like it's got slightly more travel. If you put air volume spacers in, it will feel a lot more progressive and a little bit more supple at the beginning of the stroke, but that can actually make it feel like the back end has slightly less travel. So I would just get used to riding the bike as it is, to be honest. I think it's absolutely fine, and rest assured, it will cope with almost anything you throw at it. Now up front, you definitely could extend the fork to cater for a little bit more travel. Now I wouldn't go more than 120 millimeters, so adding 20 millimeters to the 100 you've already got on there, because you will just make the bike a little bit too relaxed and the handling gets a bit wishy-washy. So at 120 with 100 out back, it'll feel like a really good bike. Now again, it depends on what model of fork you have. I'm assuming it's probably got a Fox or a RockShox on there. Now some forks around that era, you could effectively internally adjust them to give more or less travel, but more commonly these days on both Fox and RockShox forks, if you want to increase the travel on a fork, you will need a new air tube inside. Now this is a relatively inexpensive part and it's fairly easy to fit if you're into your home mechanics. All you really need to be able to do is a lower leg service essentially, and then take out that air leg unit on the inside. If you want to know how to do a lower leg service, I'm throwing a link to that in the description below this video. And if you feel comfortable with something like that, then I'm pretty confident you'll be able to change that air tube. Now you can get these from 20 to 50 quid depending on the model that you need for your particular fork, and you'll be able to extend that, no problems whatsoever. And if you want a little bit more help with that, if you just let me know the specific models of the shock and the fork that's on your bike, I'll see if I can make some exact recommendations for you, because I just think it's super cool to have a Jamaican mountain bike rider watching our channel. So thanks for tuning in. And that's all for now, folks. So for a couple more great videos, click down here for a fork lower leg service, and click down here if you want to see how to bleed a SRAM bleeding edge brake. As always, don't forget to get your comments in the section below. Give us a huge thumbs up and don't forget to click subscribe.